this is the Mercedes-AMG E63 S. Essentially, it's a sensible, respectable Mercedes-Benz E-Class that's been transformed into a 186-mile-an-hour bare-knuckle business-class bruiser. And it's all the better for it. Sitting very near the top of the AMG Performance Division's enviable tree of models, the E63 S is a direct rival for the BMW M5 and, in estate form, the Audi RS6. All three have huge power and huge reputations, known as the ultimate super saloons and estates in the automotive world. But what of the E63 S? Why should you care about a big, heavy limo with a big heavy engine and a price tag to match? Well, let me explain. It is worth pointing out that the E-Class is available with a range of other engines aside from the bombastic 612 horsepower V8 E63 S. Indeed, there's an entry-level E200 petrol with a 2-litre four-cylinder, not to mention the plethora of diesels, including a plug-in hybrid version that claims up to 217 miles per gallon. But enough about fuel economy, let's get back to the AMG. Right, climb behind this lovely Alcantara and leather-trimmed steering wheel, and you'll notice that the E63, or rather the E-Class as a whole, has got a slightly older Mercedes-Benz design language in the cabin, and that also translates to the infotainment system, which is the command infotainment system. You get the MBUX, the much improved MBUX system on the A-Class, the B-Class, the GLB, cars like that. But on this E-Class, it's a few years older, so you've got the command system, and it does feel a bit dated, especially when you compare it to something like the Audi RS6 or the Audi A6, which has got that nice dual screen touchscreen design. But I've got to say that you do get Apple CarPlay as standard on most E-Class trim levels, including the E63, and that is a big help because the functionality on that is excellent. I've also got no complaints about the size of the screen here. It's absolutely ginormous at 12.3 inches, and it fits really seamlessly into the whole dash design. It's not sticking out on top, it's just fitted in really nicely, and it looks like it's been cohesively designed. It sits next to another large screen which replaces your traditional dial, so it is effectively a digital dashboard display. And I've got to say, it's absolutely excellent. It doesn't feel dated at all. You've got plenty of functionality. I can view the navigation, radio, media, trip computer, telephone information. And there's also some unique AMG graphics for the E63, so you can see things like a G meter and your turbo boost gauge. All very exciting. However, the technology, the screens, all of that, you get it on a regular E-Class. What I really want to talk about with this interior, and it's, again, a lot of it is on an E-Class, but the E63 does this brilliantly, and it's the sense of occasion. There's these lovely swooping lines coming down here, which are highlighted by 64-colour ambient lighting, which you can obviously see at night. There's tons and tons of carbon fiber swathed throughout the cabin. It looks absolutely fantastic. You've got these round air vents, not the usual square. There's a lovely analog clock down there. There's these AMG bucket seats, which are absolutely fantastic. They are electric and memory as well. The Burmester surround sound system, and just tasteful bits of chrome. So you've got them here around the air vents, on the wheel, as I said, the wheel, Alcantara and leather. It feels like a proper occasion in here in a way that rivals just don't quite seem to match up to. I mean, I've no doubt that this is a £100,000 car. It's properly special.
Standard equipment on this E63S Premium Plus model is vast and includes goodies such as electrically adjustable heated memory seats, a 360-degree parking camera, Burmester surround sound audio, and the full Driving Assistance Plus pack featuring adaptive cruise control and active lane guidance.
Meanwhile, if you find yourself sitting in the back of an E63S, then the good news is that it still is a Mercedes-Benz E-Class. So you've got loads of knee room, got loads of headroom, although actually my feet are a little bit tight underneath this front seat, but still it doesn't take away from the fact that I've got lots of space to stretch out and relax. I've also got my own climate control settings down here. I've got two USB points and a 12 volt charging point for your gadgets. I've got a nice center armrest with cup holders and a storage space in there. And there's two ISOFIX points as well.
The E63S comes with 540 litres of boot space and 40-20-40 split folding rear seats as standard. For context, this is slightly more than the 530-litre BMW M5, and if you were to get the estate version of the E63, it easily betters the luggage capacity offered by the Audi RS6 Avant. Before we get on to the driving section of this review, here are four things you need to know before buying a Mercedes-Benz E-Class. If you really want to go full lifestyle in your E-Class, roof rail carrier bars, a bicycle rack, and official roof box are all available for purchase. When tested in 2016, the Mercedes-Benz E-Class was awarded a 5-star Euro NCAP safety rating. Like all Mercedes-Benz cars, the E-Class, including AMG models, comes as standard with a 3-year unlimited mile warranty. And finally, due to their higher fuel consumption, Mercedes-AMG E-Class models come with an 80-litre fuel tank, as opposed to the regular model, 66 litres.
Now, obviously, the E63S started out life as a regular E-Class, so it was a luxury car that's been transformed into a performance car by AMG. But because of the magic of modern drive modes, you should still be able to have both comfort and sportiness, depending on what mood you're in. So with that in mind, I'll start this review in comfort mode. And you switch that using the little toggle down here. It's not like the C63S where it's got it on the wheel. It's down here, which is actually a little bit out of sight. But switch it into comfort. And I've got to say, you do need to temper your expectations a little bit, because while we have standard air suspension, the ride, even in comfort, is on the firm side. It's not unbearable. You can definitely live with it. And I'm not even going to say it's uncomfortable, but there's a noticeable difference to what you'd expect from, say, an E220D. Especially at low speeds, when you go over lots of little bumps in quick succession, it doesn't quite settle. Also, road noise from the wheels, that's increased, and the gearbox, 9-speed gearbox, it can be a little bit lumpy at low speed. So this E63S, it does its best luxurious work, if you like, at higher speeds. But none of that is particularly important, is it? Because if you wanted comfort, you wouldn't really be buying an E63S. What this car is really about is performance. So let's go through the drive modes, put it into one of the sportier ones. We've got three choices, actually: Sport, Sport Plus, and Race, and see what the difference is.
In a subtle yet menacing turn into old-school hot rod, the E63's already stiff suspension is firmed up, the engine and gearbox primed, and the exhaust switched to full firecracker setting.
I'm not going to say that switching the drive mode transforms the whole car into a two-seat supercar, but it really does make a difference which mode you're in. There's a lot of cars where the drive modes are just there to kind of bulk out the spec sheet. You can switch between whichever mode you like, and there's barely any difference. You might get heavier steering or a sharper throttle map, but in the E63S, it really makes a difference. A big difference. In fact, the engine is so muscly that I reckon it wants to burst out of the bonnet and start jumping up and down on the road. And in fact, it probably would, but AMG fits standard dynamic engine mounts, which vary their stiffness depending on driving conditions and obviously how you're driving as well. And it should go without saying that performance is truly monstrous. This 2-ton Super Saloon can hit 0 to 62 miles an hour in just 3.5 seconds if you use the launch control feature, but that's not really all it's about, because get past that speed and it just keeps on hurtling towards the horizon at a truly staggering rate. I mean, it's very turbo-led, the power. There's lots of oomph in the mid-range, but the throttle response is still pretty good, and you've got enough going towards the upper end, so about 7,000 RPM, for it still to be really good fun. I've also got to give credit to this 9-speed automatic gearbox, because although the changes aren't razor sharp, and you do feel like you sometimes lose a bit of momentum as the turbos get their act together between gears, it does change gear exactly when you ask for it, even on down changes, when you're going for really quick down changes into a corner, 2, 3 at a time, it still gives you them when you ask for them, which is really nice. Thing is though, we all knew that the engine would be pretty damn good, because this is an AMG after all. What's more interesting is how this, and I'll say it again, 2-ton saloon handles when you get to some corners. You know what, it's genuinely enjoyable, and not just for a car that weighs this much, it's enjoyable full stop. I'm not going to say that it doesn't feel its weight, because it does. You know that you're in a heavy car, but it's got the chassis and the technology to deal with it. I mean, yes, the firmest air suspension setting probably isn't best suited to a bumpy British country road, but you can just flick it into the comfort setting and still have plenty of fun with the car, because at speed, the chassis is surprisingly pliant. And then there's the carbon ceramic brakes, which are just monstrously powerful. They're like dinner plates on each corner of the car, and the way that they shed speed, whew, they can get you out of trouble, put it that way. Obviously, you've got all-wheel drive traction, but, and this might sound a bit strange, but it feels rear-wheel drive enough. It doesn't give you a sense that if you get on the power too early, you'll just get understeer. It gives you oversteer when you want it. There's an electronic limited slip differential on the E63 S, and it allows you to just get that bit of slip at the rear if you go looking for it, and it still feels controllable. It's a really nice balance. This E63 S is far more fun than a car this size has any right to be. I mean, yes, the steering could be a bit more feelsome, and you can't get away from the fact that this is a really, really big, wide car, so that can be just something to think about when the road isn't that wide, but otherwise, it is remarkable. I'm just amazed at how friendly it is to drive quickly.
And if you want to make the E63 S less friendly, then you can engage drift mode, providing you in a suitable environment. This cuts all traction and stability aids and sends 100% of the power to the rear wheels. Do this, and you may as well order a pair of new tyres at the same time. Big V8 bruisers like the Mercedes-AMG E63 S are now few and far between. Their brand of blatant excess is both unique and questionable at a time of such massive change for both the automotive industry and planet as a whole.
But just put all of that aside for 1 second, because if you love excessive, brawny, monstrously powerful halo cars that just happen to look like your average executive saloon, then this madcap AMG is exactly that. What a car.